Hello and welcome to our webinar today. My name is Barbara Klaus and I'm a fund analyst at Scope. Today we will speak about investing in bonds with a sustainable climate change strategy. Sustainable investment has drawn a lot of attention recently also on the bond side. Many investors would like to have their bond side made sustainable, but there are still questions whether the sacrifice return, whether they pay premium for green bonds, or if the universe is large enough and flexible enough to adjust the portfolio in terms of credit or duration. For example, the Green Bond Index and the Common Green Bond Market Index has an average duration of 9 years, which is quite a lot of interest rate risk when investors are expecting or are speaking about rising inflation and rising bond yields, especially in long end that we have seen over the last days and weeks. So, today, to answer our questions, we have fund manager Ronald van Steenwegen here, the manager of Degroof Petercam's climate bond strategy, which was launched in June 2019. This fund is managed with an active strategy and therefore has a wider set of possibilities to generate return for investors. We will speak with the manager about his strategy and how he selects climate bonds, his current view, and his outlook on a sustainable bond universe. Before we start with a question and answer session with Ronald, please note that you have the possibility to ask questions during the webinar. If you have a question, you can type them in the chat window on the right, either in English or in German language. So then let's get started with the webinar. So hello, Ronald. Great to have you on board here today.
Thank you. Glad to be here.
Good, good. So let's start with the first question. Of course, I'm asking about what the reasons behind it were that you have launched climate bond strategy.
Yes, so I think it's pretty important to realize that we are an active and sustainable research-driven asset manager. And we were triggered by the development of green bonds back in 2017-2018. So basically, you asked ourselves a question, how as an active manager, are we able there to find the fixed income strategy that would leverage on our three key pillar strengths? And I think our unique selling proposition today that we have is that we focus on climate change, so that it is a real thematic fund that we have on offer today. We incorporate as well broader sustainability criteria, and we try to combine this with fundamental research and active management. And I think that will allow for a more diversified portfolio and that is able to generate above average market adjusted returns, risk adjusted returns. And I think it's probably something that we feel is pretty unique in the current marketplace today.
Yes, definitely. So also the webinar title was more than just green bonds. So you are looking beyond the green bond universe, and we are asking the question of why do you think it makes sense to look wider than the green bond universe? And how do you select the issuance or issuers you include into your universe? What are your criteria for that?
Yes, so I think we need to find ourselves a focus on a bit of a few questions before we can delve into the answers. So first of all, launching a thematic fund is always a big question. Okay, is your team basically material enough to launch a thematic strategy? And I think with climate change, we can acknowledge that it's real, it's top of mind of many investors. I think for decades to come, not only for investors, but also for policymakers. I think climate change will disrupt, is a very disruptive trend for many companies, but also for governments. So they are mixing it with governments. So in an aggregate strategy, I think does make sense. It will create, given this disruption, it will create a big impact on asset markets in general. So you will see winners, losers, it will create opportunities and it could create risks. So this is basically a very good setup of launching a thematic strategy. I think the very big advantage that we like on green bonds is that you're able to combine basically this positive environmental benefit with direct financing. So this use of perceived logic is very important for us. The big question there becomes, okay, for green bonds, is there a sufficient amount of green bonds available to tackle the problem? And the problem at large is climate change. And I think there we might want to see a bit of some more evidence that this is the case. And if you run through a few numbers, this is data from back to the end of last year, but the story remains very similar. There are many organizations that try to quantify the financing needs to tackle climate change, so to navigate the world to a low carbon economy, or let's say alignment with the one or below 1.5 degree scenario. And this is a massive amount of money that is needed. And I think if you just, even although that green bonds, they grow at a very high double-digit numbers, so 30% last year, and we expect this trend to continue. In general, they still make up about 1% of the entire global fixed income market. And they're also about maybe, so that's a 1.2 trillion market today. And if you look at the financing needs of 90 trillion to tackle climate change, of course, it's a bit difficult to justify that by investing with green bonds only, you will be able to make a material difference. This is not to say that this positive environmental benefit is not there, and we are supporting the market, and I think it's a very, very appealing sustainable strategy to invest, but it has some drawbacks, and these drawbacks is that it basically is, from pure size perspective, it is not that excellent to tackle the problem, and we would also like to basically enlarge the scope of our eligible investment universe. For one thing, is to create a more diversified opportunity set to be truly actively managing this, but also to finance the transition, because what you will see are some of the market characteristics that you have within green bonds. They are quite sector tilted. They have a bit of a high quality, long duration, low yield bias. And this is not necessarily bad, but as an investor, you need to be aware of it. So only looking at the green aspect of the bond is one thing. And there, of course, it's a very clear positive environmental benefit, and we like that very much. But we'd also like, of course, to look at, let's say, the return perspective and the risk perspective. And from a risk-return perspective, it's not that all great. And that boils to the question, okay, is this like the structural alpha within green bonds, or is this like a universe in which we are able to properly build an actively managed portfolio? And I think there, what we see, or at least see, our main evidence, what we tend to work with, let's say our base case assumption, is that there is no structural alpha in green bonds. Why is this? I think from a theoretical point of view, you have this direct use of proceeds logics, which is super beneficial for investors. But the risk, of course, remains at the issuer. So investing in green projects can be financed via green bonds. The use of proceeds logic ring fences this on the balance sheet of the issuer. But the return profile of the projects, they do not flow back to the bondholders, and the risk of the bondholder is also essentially a claim on the issuing entity. So from a pure risk return perspective, there is a cut being made between the green projects that are being financed and the proceeds of the bond, or let's say the risk return profile of the bond. So from a theoretical point of view, I would assume there would be no premium, especially in free markets where there's very active markets, which basically would remove any relative value opportunity there. This is also something that we see if you really correct for green bond indices. So if you sector neutralize and duration neutralize all these indices, you basically end up with a very similar performance. So the past, the empirical evidence seems to suggest that there's not a real structural alpha driver there. But I think more importantly, and if you look into this slide, if you look at pure from a risk perspective, if you were to look at green bonds only and look at this index, for active manager, what you would like to build from a robust portfolio is exposure to different risk premia, because then across the cycle, you will be able to deliver, let's say, a more robust return profile. And given the structure of green bonds today, and this is something which we witnessed already back in 2018, is that there's little diversification available within the green bond market due to this high quality, long duration bias. And we see issuer diversification happening. We see issuance diversification happening. So you see green convertibles bond being issued, green hybrids and the likes. But in general, I think you have this high quality, long duration dies by the nature of the fact that you invest in very long-term green projects, which you then finance in fixed income markets, and you have governments entering the market as well. This will only increase this long duration bias. So I think if you really look at the risk perspective of this index and then the levels we show here, it's a value at risk metric because basically we look at more from the downside perspective, is that a green bond is solely based interest rate risk. So we basically split in this exercise the risk profile. You see the level, so which is the number on top of the charts, where you see there you have a value at risk of about 2.5% while investing in the Euro Green Bond Index. And there the decomposition is important. It could be a differentiating factor if you would combine credit risk with interest rate risk and any other risk premium. But what you see in essence is basically you will run a very high interest rate risk portfolio. And then doing active management on one risk factor is a bit counterintuitively, of course. And you would even argue that the pure levels, they're even higher. So if you would compare the Euro Aggregate Index with the Euro Green Bond Index, the level is higher because basically the duration profile is longer. But the decomposition also, even with the Euro Aggregate Index, that's solely interest rate risk. And unfortunately, this is the time that we're living. And then probably due to central bank intervention and all the likes, this is probably here to stay. But from a fixed income point of view, it's not the ideal setup. So therefore, we allow a bit for more flexibility in our eligible universe while remaining green, building up additional risk premium. And this allows us better to recalibrate the portfolio that makes sense in the current environment, but also in the future environment. And then maybe just the last point of it. We focus a lot on, let's say, Euro fixed income investments. So we have a performance and a risk metrics, which is the Euro aggregate. We can allow a certain bucket of FX flexibility in there because it reduces the risk profile because it can be decorrelated with the interest rate risk component. But we don't run a full global portfolio because there you clearly see in this example going from a Euro portfolio to a global portfolio is jumping up in the risk profile, and also the decomposition is completely different. So due to the fact that the fixed volatility is much higher than rate volatility, at least for the time being or historically speaking, we completely alter the risk profile of the portfolio. And you should basically ask yourself more the question, not which is the type of bond or which is the interest rate that we're running, but which is the fixed portion that we're running in this fixed income portfolio. So our main focus area here is basically your Euro aggregate fixed income investor that allows for a bit of additional flexibility. And then this kind of wraps up the way of thinking that we came across while launching this strategy.
Okay, thank you very much, Ronald. I think this chart is really vital for the audience because it really shows where the risk in different universes come from, and that you can see that you are mainly running rate risk in this Euro aggregate or Euro green bond indexes, while when going global, the FX risk is enormous. And especially from a diversification standpoint, it makes sense to mix the different risks together in a portfolio, like you can see it on the left side in the climate trends portfolio. So I just also want to point it out because I also think that a mix of risk drivers makes sense here. And when you look at the total risk here, it is comparable to the Euro aggregate index, but different drivers, right? So a bit more credit risk, but less rate risk.
Yeah, correct.
Good. Then thank you very much. And I would like to move on to the process of the fund, because after we've spoken about the investable universe, could you quickly walk us through the process? So how you conduct your top-down allocation in the fund and how you select the bonds in the fund, and also what role investment themes play for you?
Yes, definitely. So I think a key concept is basically this slide. So it all starts with the fact is that we need to have a clear and direct link with climate change. So we have a proprietary eligible investment universe that we built ourselves from the ground up. And that is basically sourced by either green bonds, because there you have clearly the environmental link already available, We expanded, and then there comes a bit of the answer to why going beyond green bonds. We want to finance, of course, as well, companies or issuers in general that are climate conscious, but they're also financing or helping the transition, or basically already providing the services and the products to facilitate the transition. And within this strategy, from a pure fixed income portfolio point of view, it adds to the opportunity set, it adds to the diversification set, but it's also something that we think is purely from an environmental point of view, pretty important. And of course, climate change is a pretty broad topic. And what we've done basically is we've got this, our Emerald Universe, which is an acronym for a subset of climate-related themes, which we then can link or remap again with all of our issuers. And I think this is pretty important. So the starting point of the entire process is that we will find an issuing entity, whether it be a corporate or a government, that we can link directly or majority link to one of these sub-themes. And whether it's a green bond or a non-green bond, basically is a less important question. That link needs to be established. And once the link is established, it's basically part of the potential eligible universe. Of course, it's not that, given the fact that green bonds do not have this structural alpha driver behind it, it's pretty difficult to just build up a portfolio on the base of this climate assessment that we do. Okay, we'll skip this one for the sake of time. And this is the actual investment process visualized. So the key center point is this climate assessment. And this is this emerald mapping, which we've shown before. Of course, there are, let's say, a few steps precluding this climate assessment. And this basically is, okay, we run a fixed income portfolio. So we don't have really a geographical bias. So it's global, as in nature. Of course, the market as such is pretty Euro-focused, which we tend to like. But we screen, at least, let's say we pre-screen our universe, let's say for liquidity reasons and all the like, so that we end up with a basically standardized, plain vanilla, liquidity-proof portfolio. And then the second step is basically incorporating general corporate sustainability criteria. So the fund is called Climate Trends Sustainable. The sustainable part does also make a difference. I think at TPAM level, we kind of define what we consider to be sustainable, and given the fact that we are running a sustainable fund, we definitely are looking for these teams. So we do a normative screening, we make sure that we align with the UN principles, we do exclusions and controversies. So if there's a company which is blacklisted or is very controversial, we would exclude it from our universe. We also do a best-in-class approach, so we integrate as much as possible sustainable factors at large. But it's essentially an exclusion, let's say a removal of the eligible universe. So the climate assessment allows for issuers to come on the eligible universe. The general sustainability profile of the issuer can make it be removed from the eligible universe. And then in a secondary step and a third step, we basically do an ESG integration, but we also look at the fundamental profile of each of the issues. So we have an internal credit analyst team, about seven people that run through all the companies. And they look at the fundamentals, they look at the liquidity profile, they look at the general investment case from a pure non-green bond perspective. And of course, this allows us to justify the business case of investing in a green bond or in non-green bond, because it does need to make sense from a pure fundamental or credit point of view. It will not make sense that investing in a green bond that is about to default is not really the thing that we're after, of course. So it's a dual investment. So we do the research on the climate perspective, but we also do the research on the credit and the fundamental point of view. And so this is basically, it generates the buying list that we have within the fund. And then the macro views, that's maybe less thematic, but that's the way we think, okay, where are interest rates going? Which is the credit profile that we like to run in the current environment or in the future environment, preferably? What is the valuation of different parts of the market? Where do we see value? Where do we see risks? And basically, there we buy this. We mix these themes together with the eligible universe, which has been screened essentially on a green nature, where some removal has been done from the sustainability part, and that has been vetted by internal credit research team. We build this together with the risk model into the final portfolio. And it's that portfolio that is basically being managed on a day-to-day basis by the portfolio management team. So I think the roles and responsibilities are also pretty important in this respect. We don't do the climate assessment. So we have a dedicated ESG team in-house that does this for consistency reasons, of course. We have an internal credit team who runs to the companies and the issuers. And basically, we, together with the macro team and the other portfolio manager team, develop a strategy on how do you want to position ourselves in the current environment. And this is not really linked to whether the fund is green or not. It's basically linked to what would be any fixed income portfolio as an active manager look like in today's environment. And I think this is important to sketch out for the audience that it's not the portfolio manager who's doing ESG screenings or running climate assessments. Those are dedicated specialists to do this. And we cannot overrule them either. So we cannot really push for ideas. We interact a lot. We talk a lot because sometimes you get interesting insights from this, of course. But there's clear roles and responsibility, which makes the process relatively robust in our view.
Okay, thank you very much for providing us an overview over your investment process. I have one detailed question about your sustainability and climate assessment. I've understood that you do two different assessments, the ESG assessment, looking at every point of the company, E, S, and G, and do exclusions and a best-in-class approach, and you do a climate profile. So could you please walk us through an example to illustrate it?
Yes, sure. Let's maybe go back to the previous slide. So of course, if you were to invest, let's take the Ørsted, for instance. So this is both a green bond issuer and a climate enabler. So it's a 100% renewable energy company. It has done a very big transition over the last 5 to 10 years. So what we do there, if a green bond issues to the market, what we do there is basically a climate assessment. And maybe if we will just quickly go through one slide here, this will show you. So the green bond checklist, what we call it, this is an assessment when there's a green bond coming to the market. So we are alignment of the green bond principles. I think it is pretty standard and straightforward. We externally validate, of course, as well. It is not that we're going on site and look at all the projects. So we require a second party opinion, a climate bond label or a green bond rating. But I think, so we kind of onboard all the relevant information that we get from the market and from external parties, but we do our own qualitative assessment in the end to finally decide whether for us this green bond makes sense in our Emerald universe. And this is an alignment for let's say the green nature of the bond with the corporate strategy. You will find sometimes issuer that tend to focus on trends and see if there's a premium in the market. They try to tap the market for cheap and financing. But if the company's green strategy is not well supported throughout your organization, and you will quickly find this out because you have close contacts with the companies from the credit analyst team and the likes, there, of course, there's being red flags there. And typically, we do not engage. So about on average, maybe from all the green bonds that we analyze, probably about 80 to 85% that go through, although they're in line with the green bond principles and they have been externally validated. But we feel there that maybe the use of proceed logic is not materially enough, or the way that the use of proceeds are done is not in line with the corporate strategy, or might maybe be for within the sector assessment. If there's a real estate company, or let's say, and they're just refinancing old past buildings and they're just resurfacing them for just a little bit, this is basically not enough. So we do an assessment, and this is also based upon external data that we look for, basically some interesting points that show that there is a material additional environmental benefit while investing in the company or in structure, being here in this case a green bond. So, and this is the ESG team who does this for consistency reasons. And they will give you, in the end, the final result is a go or no go, depending on this. And I think from the sustainability angle, so yes, we do these more quantitative screenings, but this is general, I think, for more sustainable profiles. But I think in here, we look at the issuers. If it's a green bond, a principal alignment, that's a necessity. An external validation is a necessity as well. But then we also look at the use of perceived logic and the general corporate sustainability profile, and it should be a match there as well. But in average, most of the time, you see that green bond issuers tend to focus a lot on let's say more general sustainable purposes. So it's pretty rare to find things that go completely on the opposite side. But they do exist, and then maybe if the market continues to grow at this pace, then probably you will find some less obvious candidates that try to tap the market. But again, it's important to have analysis done internally to have these additional quality checks. It's called a lineup.
Okay, thank you very much, Ronald, for walking us through that example. Before we move on to the second part of the webinar, where we would like to touch on performance and also portfolio and your outlook, I would just like to quickly sum up the key points to our investors. So the key point is that it's an active strategy, that it goes beyond the green bond universe to have more choice, because the green bond universe is significantly tilted towards long duration and also towards a very good credit quality. And the fund manager here has more choice in investing in a broader range of credit qualities and also in a broader range of duration. And also also to a limited amount, there's a possibility to invest into foreign exchange, foreign currencies. So the process itself has different elements. First, the asset climate element, where the bonds are allocated to the climate universe by breaking down the climate theme into sub-themes called the Emerald System. And they also do an additional ESG analysis, which is based on exclusion criteria and best in class. And of course, they are running with their credit team a fundamental analysis about the credit of the issuer and develop a top-down view, because it's not only a green portfolio, but it should also perform well and have a fundamental basis, which is why these three elements play nicely together here. So then I would like to move on about to the performance of the fund. So I would like to hand over back to Ronald, if we could speak a little bit about the fund's performance since launch and what the main drivers were. And of course, we are all very curious how the fund performed during the pandemic, the recovery, and maybe if we have already data in there over the last days and weeks when we had this rate rise and inflation discussion.
Okay, excellent. So on the performance side, let's quickly go in here. If you were to compare the performance we compare ourselves to is the Euro Aggregate Index, because basically we want to give you our investors, let's say, an above market risk-adjusted return. So since inception, which was June 2019, we're up 3.6% in absolute terms versus the index. We're above 1% today. I think yesterday, or even let's say a few days ago. Of course, the volatility has increased a bit, especially on the interest rate part due to central bank verbal interventions and the likes. So I think in general, we conclude that we're up. With delivering a horizon for this expected outperformance is in general 2 to 3 years. So after 1 year and a half, we're up 1% net of fees. We find this to be a decent result. Of course, looking to the pandemic and the relative chart, it's fair to say that versus a Euro Aggregate Index, which is very much geared towards treasuries, the pandemic was clearly something that caused a temporary headwind or a drawback to performance. The important point to make there, of course, when running into the pandemic, our portfolio structure was not similar to the one that we have today, but it was also very much exposed to credit instead of treasuries or let's say more pure sovereign bonds. There were various reasons to be positioned for that at that particular point in time. Of course, the pandemic hit. You've seen a very big rally and flattening of the curve, especially on risk-free, but also on more peripheral sovereign bonds due to the very sharp reaction of central banks at that point in time, but also on the fiscal response, which came pretty quick after the pandemic. And those two factors, I think, were very key for us to profit from the widening of credit spreads, because we felt that the pandemic as such could be overcome by a very large and unprecedented monetary and fiscal stimulus. So we were not too pessimistic at that point in time. Of course, the market was very volatile, and there were some very abrupt things happening there. So we indeed took a bit of a hit in the performance, but the general strategy did not really materially change. And I think we recovered pretty nicely on the back of that. And I think last month, or let's say recent month data, suggest that we're back on the right track of delivering these above market returns for the foreseeable future. So I think that this kind of wraps the performance part. Of course, there's a lot of details behind this and a lot of different teams and a lot of different ways of positioning the portfolio. I think it's probably better if we go to our outlook, what we think today, in line with how we are positioned today. And I probably will ask already a few questions, because in the end, as an active manager, it's the ideas that you put into the portfolio that will drive the future performance. So the ideas are probably the more interesting part. I think, of course, it's fair to say today, if you would compare ourselves to an index, again, our eligible universe is completely different. So our starting point is different. But we tend to disregard this to some extent and then build a robust portfolio nonetheless. So it's pretty heavily tilted towards credit still today. We find various reasons for this. So we have a very significant, or we call it in this type of analysis, an underweight in treasury. Of course, you are within treasury, you have a few issues there. So that limits the opportunity set. But also really from a pure valuation point of view or a macro point of view, we would disregard, or let's say not position heavily for interest rates to collapse back to previous levels. And statistic in general, so what we're able to deliver and the duration profile here is shown as well. So we have about a 1% yield to maturity, an average rating of BBB plus, 87% is euro denominated. We have eight other currency pairs in the portfolio. Our duration is 6, which is clearly less than the market and definitely less as the green bond market. And our fund size is about a little bit over 210 million for the time being. This is the risk return profile. And again, what we're looking for is a better risk adjusted profile, because in the end, this will deliver performance. We do not target explicitly yield levels. They're basically the result of the macro view and of the other parts of the investment process. So we will not steer away. We can be long duration if we want. We can be low yield if we want, but then we need to have a justification for this positioning. I think this will skip for time. Our portfolio outlook in very, very high level details, and I think we will come to the logic behind it, is that we are pretty, from a valuation point of view, underweighting pure treasuries. On credit, we still like it, although that the valuation is clearly on a historical basis substandard. Technicals are good due to SVB intervention. Sentiment is pretty straightforward, especially because we're on the verge of probably a very potential good growth outlook for the medium term, which typically works very well for more riskier asset and credit spreads in general. On EM, we're turning a bit more positive after the rising real rates of the US. We have seen that valuation of EM and EMFX especially. It's pretty interesting. Also, in a better growth environment, these type of investments should perform well. Of course, a lot of these different things, they could be interesting from a pure macro perspective. But we also look at what is the opportunity set that we have within the green space, of course. And there is this column which basically denotes where is it that we find a lot of opportunities today and in the future, what we'd see probably that in the future we have much more opportunities across these different parts of the market. But I think today in credit in general, you have the biggest opportunity set available. That also explains a bit of why we tilt the portfolio to the credit component, because the logic does not really work in a way that we like a certain macro team. So we will reduce the threshold levels that we use to find semi-green issuers and put them in the portfolio. The sequencing of the investment process is fine. Okay, we first do the climate assessment. If that is okay, we do all the rest. So it doesn't come from the other way around. It's not that because we like convertible bonds from pure macro or valuation point of view that we're going to look into the convertible bond market, do kind of a screening, and then assume that the top 25% of this emission screening is considered to be a green convertible. So this is not the way that we operate. We do this climate assessment prior to that. And in the end, if the opportunity set is not there, we cannot use it. But again, I think that the trend probably goes in the line that we will find opportunity sets much more over the near future, because you see this issuer diversification happening across the sector. And maybe the very big outlook questions that we have today, or let's say the two main questions that we think that investors should ask themselves and have a response to that, is there a real risk of permanent scarring of the economy of the pandemic? Pretty difficult, because it doesn't happen each year, of course, a big pandemic as this. And there we tend to look at the evidence, and the evidence, this is shown of an analysis done by the ECB that look at past pandemics. There's a bit of a pattern in there, is that you have a temporary shock, but the economy is able to recover from that. Of course, you could argue this pandemic has been very big, but I think what you need to realize as well is that the fiscal and monetary response has been at least as big, and in some parts of the world, even bigger. And I think this slide kind of wraps it up pretty well. So this is IMF compiled data from an independent research house, and it shows you that vis-a-vis the global financial crisis, which has also led to a monetary and policy response, of course, we're pointing to multiple times as much fiscal impulse working in combination with monetary policy extremely accommodative. So monetary policy has been accommodative in a global financial crisis as well. Monetary policy is today still very accommodative. What is the main difference is that the fiscal policy today works in combination with monetary policy, which is extremely loose. And the size of the fiscal policy is very big. It's even bigger than, especially in the US, the hole that has the pandemic filled. So this is kind of a different experiment, which we didn't see for the last 25 years, especially on the global financial crisis. You could have argued to a certain extent that going into the global financial crisis, you had imbalances in the economy that needed an external shock. And basically that particularly throughout the economy. It's very difficult to argue that pre the pandemic, we were facing an economy which was highly imbalanced, and therefore any external shock whatsoever, being a pandemic or something else, would have permanent damage on the economy. I don't think this is the case. And therefore, we think we're pretty upbeat on the growth trajectory over the next 2 to 5 years. Also comparing here the relative regional differences. So the US, basically, it goes very big, very fast. The euro area there, what we think is very positive is that this is first, of course, the direct financing stimulus. So it does not include the loans of the Next Gen Fund, to be pretty precise. But let's say the imminent response on the fiscal side has been good, not as big enough in the euro area, but the composition has been very, very different. So the US fiscal stimulus is pretty consumer-led, very big, and actually tries to make consumption be the driving force of the recovery. I think in the euro area, it's much more structurally diverse. And what it tries to do is tries to link structural challenges in the euro area, which is basically an underinvestment and some others, and tries to bypass the structural differences that we had in the past, and which were a very low growth potential scenario for the area, and tries to overcome this via direct spending and tries to stimulate, especially on digital and on green, large-scale investment projects. And I think what we're seeing today is some very big investment capex spending plans of certain companies. So they're following this logic. And then if you look at the historical evidence, during recessions or highly volatile, uncertain environments, doing structural reforms at cheap levels typically generates a lot of fiscal multipliers, especially if companies, consumers and the like find this to be a credible alternative. And I think this can become kind of a virtuous cycle to a certain extent, that monetary policy will keep interest rates pretty low, not at current low levels. They could go higher because, of course, if the growth outlook changes, that fundamental outlook will change as well. But the combination of fiscal probably can bridge the gap that consumers have and companies have, and can even sometimes refurbish structural damage that has been done from the past. So I think we could look for a very prosperous future also in the euro area, with maybe at first sight that the fiscal stimulus seems to be lagging the US. But I think that the drivers behind it are pretty different. And from a pure, let's say, growth potential outlook, is probably well suited for the current economic environment. So I think we're pretty happy about this. And this all translates to a fact that interest rates are probably likely to rise further from here. Probably not very fast, because central banks will try as much as possible to tame any unwarranted financial tightening or whatever you want to call it. But they will need to realize, because they continue to point to a very, cautious outlook on the recovery, but the incoming data is pretty solid and pretty good. So in certain due times, and then their policy review gives them additional time, this average inflation targeting regime, which they're currently adopting to in the US and the euro area, will buy them additional time to keep monetary policy too loose for basically the economy. So in the end, what we're witnessing today is kind of pro-cyclical fiscal policy combined with pro-cyclical monetary policy. And this is something that we have not seen over the last 20 to 25 years. So it's very difficult to assess what will be the impact on asset markets, because we have not seen this for the last 20 to 25 years. I think the likelihood is that you would see trend growth increase, and that you will see inflation increase across the horizon as well. And of course, this typically does not bode well for long-dated, high-quality treasury bonds, which are being suppressed to a certain extent from price-insensitive actors such as the central bank. So at a certain point in time, they will all need to face reality, and I think then monetary policy can change. And of course, this will be a driver of future interest rates going forward. And then the likely scenario is that this will be higher than before, especially in inflation. And maybe to conclude there, in an inflation, we've been accustomed to inflation surprising to the downside. So we never were accustomed to inflation being surprised to the upside. So while all central banks, that they continue to show medium-term outlooks in line with their targets, they never really met them. So they have a credibility problem. And I think there, what the bond market has done, it has suppressed the term premium. So the additional component to justify, a long duration stance is that, okay, if you're in another situation where inflation is the real risk of a permanent loss of capital from your bond holding, if that is not materializing anytime soon and unlikely to materialize over a very long horizon, you basically want to ride the curve and pick higher yields, which can be found at the longer end of the maturity, to generate an additional profile. And this has compressed in combination with central bank asset purchases on the longer term bonds, of course, as well. This has suppressed the term premium. So the additional compensation that you get from rolling, let's say, from short-term bonds into long-term bonds. But of course, if inflation is likely to rise on a more structural nature, this term premium cannot be suppressed anymore, because then you will have the clear example of financial depression. And I think you see it already happening in the US, that it's the uncertainty of the inflation outlook, the potential that you're moving away from continuous downside surprises, lower inflation, to potentially higher inflation or even positive surprises on the inflation. That cannot be rhymed with the low or below zero term premium. You will need to build in a certain compensation for that for investors who continue to believe in free markets, of course. The counter argument is, of course, central banks will push you, will keep this as negative as they can, and then they will target specific yields. But I don't think that we're there yet, and I don't think this is really compatible with many of the central banks' policy statements.
Okay, thank you very much, Ronald, for this positive outlook overall. Of course, inflation is the big unknown, and we are living in a monetary experiment. So thanks for that. And this also shows in the positioning of the fund that you are a bit cautious regarding duration against the Green Bond Index, but also against the Barclay Euro Aggregate, which you use as kind of a benchmark for your active strategy, and you are positive on credit, which should benefit from the environment. So thank you very much for that. Before we move over to your outlook on the green bond market, I have seen that I have a question from the audience. I would like you to have a look and answer. So we already touched on that theme, but maybe it's a bit more of a specific question regarding the so-called greenium. So our participant asks, if you find that green bonds tend to offer in general a lower coupon as a comparable bond from a competitor with a similar credit rating, or even the same company, or put differently, which companies issue green bonds to refinance to lower rates?
Yes, so this is basically this greenium question. I think the coupon is linked to the actual state of the market, typically at primary. So if you were to compare green bonds with other ones, they have a lower coupon because probably the credit risk profile is lower, so the yield is lower, therefore the coupon is lower, all else being equal. But I think it's important to realize from an investor that looks at the primary, and I think it will just move to one slide further. This is analysis done by Barclays, not by ourselves, and it clearly shows that vis-a-vis the existing outstanding bonds, is there an additional premium that you pay in the primary? Because I think many participants acknowledge the fact that you have ESG investors and normal investors, and investing in a green bond for a normal investor or not ESG specific investors is not necessarily bad. If you assume that you want to greenify your portfolio, normal investors probably are looking at the market as well. So the question is, Is there a premium to be paid upfront at primary? And is this premium, how big is it? And is this probably linked to a difference in rating, a difference in whatever? And this analysis shows that today there is a premium that investors pay. So the issuer has a benefit. It's around 8 to 9 basis points at primary. So if you invest in a primary issue of a green bond issuer or another issuer, you typically pay 10 basis points, or the yield that you get on the bond is about 10 basis points lower than a comparable bond, all else being equal. So correcting for the difference in rating, correcting for a difference in jurisdiction, correcting for a difference in subscription, and so all else being equal, you pay an additional premium in the primary market.
Okay, thank you very much, Ronald, for answering that question. And now I would like to come to the last part of today's webinar and to your outlook on the investable universe. So it has already grown strongly over the last years, which you can see, for example, in the green bond issuance, which has picked up tremendously. But as you have said, it's still a small market, but it's rapidly growing. So could you share your outlook with us, whether you expect this growth to continue, and what trends or changes do you see in the universe, for example, in regard of sectors or new issuance?
Okay, excellent. So this basically plots a bit on how sustainable finance has evolved since 2010. So you see this ramp up as from 2016 onwards. That's basically the maturing of the green bond market, or let's say that green bonds become a mainstream investment theme. What we've seen, and that's very recent, of course, during the pandemic, you had a bit of a switch between social bond issuance, which is something that we cannot take, of course, in this portfolio. But also you see a new type of bonds emerging, which is called sustainability-linked bonds. So basically, the difference between a green bond and a social bond is, of course, the use of perceived logic. One is green projects, the other is social projects. Then you have sustainability bond. This is a typical more ESG, bigger ESG profile in which you're able to combine social and greens into one bond issuance. So it's a combination of both. And then you have sustainability linked bonds, where you don't have a use of perceived logic. So you basically finance the company, but the company predefines a certain set of key performance indicators that could be sustainability linked. So it could be we want to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by 25% over X amount of time. And if they do not achieve these targets, the bond structure profile will change. So the coupon will change or the redemption profile will change. And we see this as a very nascent trend. So it only emerged end of 2020. And I think over the last 2-3 months, we've seen an avalanche of new bonds being issued under this format, because I think they're from a pure environmental impact point of view. Those are high emitting sectors that are issuing, they're doing their best, they're showing clear commitment, and they're also putting a certain amount of efforts in developing this market, which could potentially be much bigger than the green bond market. But I think the green bond market as such, so it's about 1.2 trillion market today. The year-on-year rate is 70%. So we will continue to grow at 50, 60%. So I think we made a forecast end of 2010 that we're about 2 trillion mid-2022. I think we're still in line. But this, the main portion will remain green bond within this framework. But we think that there's a high potential for sustainability linked bond. I think this is clearly something which we can hold into our portfolio because they're clearly aligned with the challenger assessment. But it's also something that I think from an environmental impact point of view is pretty important. Of course, if you have a green only bond fund, those will be excluded. And I think this shows a bit on how is the market evolving. It's a bit of a weird donut chart, but it shows that there's a lot more colors coming from. So the inner circle is 2015 or something, or 2016. The outer circle is last year. What you see that there is a lot more diversification coming. In sectors, you will find issuers that are finding the right projects and repackaging them under the green bond framework. But you will see also new issuers coming to the market. What we've seen, for instance, car manufacturing over the last year in 2020 came to the market, which was not there. So indeed, green bonds will remain, it will become even more diversified over the years to come. I think they will remain, let's say, too little diversified to really build on a very big active portfolio. Because you will have a tendency, you see it now today, Italy will come to the market, Spain is likely to come to the market over the next few weeks. So the very large likelihood is that you will continue to see an involvement versus the Euro aggregate index, because big issuers typically are governments. France, I think, is a big issuer, as is the first 50 to 100 corporates. So you might move towards an aggregate index composition within the green bond index, probably with a higher duration profile nonetheless, because inherently in green bonds, you have this long-term project horizon. Of course, issuers, they don't want to issue short-term bonds to finance long-term projects. So I think on average, you always will have a bias to a longer duration, which is not necessarily bad. But it's something that you should be aware of when you build this into a fixed income portfolio.
Yes, thank you very much. Yeah, we should definitely be aware of the longer duration in the portfolio, which I think is pretty long with 9 years. Also historically, what we have seen is that the strong rent grows, and I've also taken away that the universe gets more diverse in terms of sector, in terms of reasons behind the issuance, not only green bond, but also social bonds and other areas are covered. So thanks very much for providing this overview. And we have, last but not least, another question from the audience, which you could touch on pretty quickly in regard of time. So for the audience, if you have any other questions, we can also answer them after the webinar. So the question is, What is your opinion about ESG rating agencies? Would you use them?
Okay, fair point. I have one slide. I'll quickly guide them to there. So again, and if you want to have the full package of the slides, feel free to reach out. I think we use them. That's the short answer. Are they good? I think they're good. They're good at certain points, certain things. So in the end, what you see, and I think this is a very important point to invest at the start. If you look at credit rating agencies, they are pretty homogeneous in their opinion. So the correlation between S&P, Moody's, and Fitch, it's about 99. So you can select one, and you don't need the other because they're a bit similar. If you were do the similar exercise, and there's academic papers that are showing this, is that if you would take MSCI, Sustainalytics, and a few others, and then do it the exact same thing for ESG ratings, on average, you get a correlation of 0.5, which is materially less. So there's a lot of diversity in opinion because there's not a general good definition of what is sustainability. And of course, there's a counter-argument that due to upcoming regulation, we will see a lot more disclosure and the likes. But again, it's not that Sustainalytics has invented sustainability and therefore they hold the truth. They are also 250 analysts there that are doing a rating for 5 or maybe 15,000 companies based upon surveys and other data points. So they are very good at analyzing very big data sets and then add a qualitative opinion to this. But it is sometimes subjective. I think with the environmental aspect, there's more clear alignment. I think the correlations there are much higher. But for governments and social, I think what we've done is basically did a qualitative assessment of the various ones. And therefore, controversies, we tend to use Sustainalytics a lot. Governments, we tend to like MSCI. And for carbon and environmental data, we look at true costs. So we're not paid to name them today. But again, it's okay, where do we think that some have an edge? And then we onboard this information into our process. But we also want to give, let's say, an additional qualitative internal opinion on this. And if we do ESG integration, it's with credit analysts that use this information, but they also use other types of information coming from companies, coming from NGOs, coming from other things. And that basically is the end of the analysis. And then I think it can reinforce a certain way of thinking. I would caution against externalizing too much or relying too much on ratings. I think we've seen back in 2008 heavy reliance on outsourcing responsibilities to external party can sometimes be maybe not the best investment advice ever. But they do a good job at certain points. But there are open questions at certain others. So I would not take them for granted, knowing that they tend to diversify from opinion amongst each other as well.
Okay, and thank you, Ronald, for answering that question from the audience. I think we are coming to the end of the webinar for today. So thank you very much, Ronald, for being with us. It was really interesting and we could have gone on for hours. But I think we will end the webinar for today. If the audience, as I said, has any other question, want to know more, they can always get back to us for more information. So thanks for being here today, Ronald, and guiding us through your process and your outlook. And also thanks to the audience for being here today. I think we had a great webinar, and I'm looking forward to the next Scope webinars with you. So thank you all, and have a great day. Goodbye.
Thank you. Goodbye.
Bye.